Hello, everybody. Thank you for joining today. Today's presenter is Chilán. We are so excited to welcome Chilán. This is his second time coming to our global Shiatsu virtual gathering. And let's start. Pauline, will you start the slide for us? Pauline and Julie are my new students. They are super excited to learn Shiatsu. And I am so grateful to have new energy coming to our ways. I'm sure we will have more and more people who join this fall, next year, and next 50 years. Let's expand our healing energy through Shiatsu. And let's send a goodbye to everybody to go to this pandemic as well. Yes.
Yeah. Okay.
So today's presenter is Chilán from Arizona, and he's been surrounded by such a wise people. It's his nature to use the healing medicine, energy, herbs, smell, and touch. So we cannot wait to hear his information about antique points, how we can use antique points to release energy stagnation. Thank you. And let's put the both hands together and let's meditate, chant together, and let's our heart, mind together. Namu shinyo ichi nyo to 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 kimi ho to keo. Nenji tate matsuru zangi zange rokkon zaisho metsujo bon no metsujo gonsho om saraba tata gyata hanamana no gyarobi. And let's reflect ourselves, how yin yang energy is not working together, how it's not balanced in your daily life, your family, society, in this world. Please, let's send the healing energy to everybody to go through this very challenging time. And I'd like to introduce Chilán Mustain. Thank you, Chilán. Please take it over from here.
Thank you, Kumiko. Good morning, everybody. Nice to see you here. So my first training in Oriental medicine was in Shiatsu, Zen Shiatsu, going back to about, I think 2003 was the year that I started studying Zen Shiatsu. And with Zen Shiatsu, we really focus mostly on the channels. But I was very interested in a certain chart that I would see at the school that had the five elements, and then it also had like a little wheel on each one of the points of the star showing the five elements again. And that chart, what it was talking about, actually, now that I look back in retrospect, it was the antique points. And it was talking about the way that each element contains the other five elements within it. Now, I've never had any exposure to five element shiatsu, actually. So I don't know if they use these same ideas in a similar way. But what ended up happening is eventually I studied acupuncture. And when I, after I finished acupuncture school, I studied with Kuwahara sensei from Boston and studied Hari, which is Meridian Therapy, Japanese style acupuncture. And we, in that style, we used the five elements in the way that it showed on that chart so many years before. And so that interest that had been sparked many, many years ago, 2003, it finally came around in a big circle, and I could start to use it in the way that was useful to me. And so I'm just gonna talk about the idea, not so much about techniques, because if you're all shiatsu practitioners or learning shiatsu right now, you have techniques, and it doesn't really matter what techniques you use, as long as you use the points in the right way and your technique is good, there's any technique will make it work. And so I just want to talk about the antique points and a strategy that you can use to use them in the way that they were spoken about in the early texts. So the antique points are also called the five shoe points, but they say antique points because this goes back to the Lingshu. So it's over 2000 years old. These are some of the first points that were developed. So there may have been, there's other points mentioned in those ancient texts, but a lot of the points that we see on the charts today are more modern points that were discovered later. And they tend to have less functions than those older points. So all the antique points are from the elbow down or from the knee down. They're just on the limbs. And so those are the points that we use the most often. And a lot of times, if you notice, like when you're doing different movements in shiatsu, a lot of times your fingers will fall already on those points. And so it's actually not like a huge change to utilize these points, because you'll notice that these are points that you tend to already hold. You're already grabbing these points and utilizing them. And so I just want to bring some more awareness to the more subtleties of the functions that they have. Let me have you go back one slide, please. Or actually two slides. To the one more, sorry. One more. I want to see the star. The star that's on the first page. Yes, thank you. So here we have the five element diagram. Within each element has these other five elements, the same five elements again. So within the fire element, and you can see this in the seasons too. This is especially noticeable in the seasons. Within the fire element, it starts off with wood within fire, and then it moves to fire within fire, and then it moves to earth within fire, and then metal within fire, water within fire. These are all phases of the summer. Then you move into earth season, late summer, and you'll have wood within earth, fire within earth, earth within earth, metal within earth, water within earth. And so these become different subtleties of that season, and those account for the seasonal changes that we feel as things move along. If you live in the same place for a long time, you can pay attention to the seasons and you'll see. And things are shifting now because of global warming too. But if you are new to an area, it's very difficult to notice these very subtle changes, but they're definitely there. So within the body, the ancient texts talk about the interior environment as being related to the exterior environment. So the way that the acupuncture points were discussed and the meridians were discussed, we're using metaphors related to nature. So the meridians were discussed as waterways, as like rivers, you know? And so you can go to two more slides forward. One more. Perfect. Right there. It's good. Back one. Thank you. So the names of the points, you know, in English, we tend to number the points. So we call them lung one, lung two, lung three, which is super easy to learn because there's a logical sequence to it. But that's not how they were labeled in ancient times. They were labeled with names that had a poetic meaning and metaphor associated with them that gave information about what the points did. So then the points were then classified also using the same method. The five element points, or the antique points, were classified as Jingwell points, Ying Spring points, Shu Stream points, Jing River points, and He Si points. These go in a sequential progression from fingertip towards elbow, or from tips of the toes towards the knee. So the Jingwell point is where the qi emerges. This is where it's the most superficial, and these are always at the tips of the fingers or the tips of the toes, except for the exception of kidney one, which is at the bottom of the foot. And so these points are very, you can just with your fingernail feel how sensitive they are. If you've ever gotten a paper cut there or a little splinter there, it's so painful, even though it's just a tiny, tiny little cut. If you had that same little cut somewhere else, you wouldn't even notice it. But the key is so close to the surface at these points that it's very, very sensitive. So this point category, as a general classification, is useful for certain things associated with that. So because the blood slows down at the tips of the fingers and the tips of the toes, that's where the blood is flowing the slowest. These points are very good for clearing heat from inside the body because the blood slows there and it's able to vent heat to the exterior. These points in general are more useful during the winter season because in the winter our blood withdraws towards the center of the body. And so treating these points helps to counteract that and balance that nature of everything contracting inward by bringing more attention to the tips of the fingers. Tips of the fingers and toes, they get cold in the winter, right? So they're cold because there's a lack of blood and a lack of qi flowing to them. So these points, the Jingwell points, are very useful for treating those kind of conditions. There's also some other indications like stagnation in the chest area and epigastrium and emotional disorders. One of the big things that we talk about for the well points is restoring consciousness. So if somebody passes out or is on the verge of passing out, pricking these points or poking them with your fingernail or just rubbing them like this is very useful to bring that person back to consciousness. Especially like in cases of heat stroke. So somebody has too much heat and then they're starting to pass out because of too much heat. Well, these points clear heat too, right? And so very useful points for that. However, these points are super painful. Nobody wants to really have you poke your nail in there. And so we kind of just use them for more emergency situations. It's not something that we use all the time, but definitely when, you know, if you're working down a meridian this way, it's always good at the very end to give a little bit of attention to those well points at the end. And you can definitely grab some of that stagnation and pull it out this way. Next category. One more thing. So the elements about that, right? So the well points in the case of the yin channels are wood. They're associated with wood element. But within the case of the yang channels start with metal element. And this is helpful to memorize because wood is more yin than yang. Wood is more yin than metal. And so the yang channels start with a more yang point, whereas the yin channels start with a more yin point. So yin channels starts with wood and then it follows the progression of the natural progression of the generating cycle. So well points start with wood, spring points are then fire, stream points are earth, river points are metal, and sea points are water. This is within the yin channels. When you go to the yang channels, then it starts with metal and then it goes from there. It goes metal, then the spring points are water, then the shoestream points are wood, and then the river points are fire, and then the sea points are earth. And you'll see later on, I'll go through some of these flashcards here, and I'll just pick little points here and there and show you why they do what they do. So many times in classes about points, in books about points, they just talk about, oh, okay, you know, large intestine 4, it's good for sinus problems, it's good for frontal headache, it's good for this or that, right? But they don't really ever say why, and rarely do they ever discuss technique. You know, what technique should you use to treat this point? Within Shiatsu, I feel like, you know, we have the advantage of you just look for Kyo and Jitsu and you treat accordingly. Is the point Kyo or is it Jitsu? But if you're teaching somebody over Zoom, if your client is somewhere else and you're not able to see them, how do you show them, you know, this is Kyo or this is Jitsu over Zoom? That's a lot more difficult to do that education. And that's a sensitivity that takes years of practice to master. But through symptomology, you can determine, is that channel actually at that point, is that channel going to be Kyo or Jitsu, and then treat accordingly. So you can tell your client, you know, okay, press the point this way or press it that way, depending if it's Kyo or Jitsu. But if you know what that point is going to do and what proper technique to give it, then it's a lot easier to share that with people. And then of course, it can inform your own practice as well. What I've noticed is a lot of times in my head, I have an idea of, okay, I'm gonna find this point to be this quality. And using this kind of theory, usually when I go and touch that point, it will be what I thought it was gonna be. And if it's not, then I have to reassess my diagnosis, because if I thought that this was gonna be Kyo and it's actually Jitsu, then something else is going on that I missed. So moving on to spring points. The spring points are, you know, it starts with a well and then the water starts to trickle into a spring. It starts to gush out a little bit more. There's a little bit more water. And so this is a point where it's moving a little bit deeper. So we started at the fingertips and toe tips. And then the next point in, following the sequence, moving more proximally, the next one is the spring point. So the spring points, again, being very close to the ends of the tips of fingers and toes, they clear a lot of heat. These points are known for use when there's a change in complexion. So if your patient comes in very pale, or your patient comes in very red, or if they have a dark hue to their face, or something that's indicating an imbalance in one of the elements, you know, there's those indications, like if it's dark, you think of kidney. If it's yellow, you think of spleen. If it's red, you think of heart. If it's white, you think of metal. And so let's say a patient comes in and their complexion is very white. So I'm thinking, oh, it's maybe there's a metal imbalance. Well, the metal point that I would want to choose would be a spring point, because those points are going to have an association with that symptomology. Spring points are also not really, really used a whole lot. All of these points are used more than other points in general, but within the context of the shoe points or the antique points, the spring points and the jingwells are the ones that we use the least. And then moving on to the stream points, the shoe stream points, these ones are like big points, because on all the yin channels, the shoe stream points are also the source points. And the source points are one of the most important points on the meridian. Source points is where the chi enters that channel from other places in the system, and where you can really control the amount of chi that's flowing within that channel. So you can use it to reduce or augment the flow in there. And also the source points are a warming quality. And so a lot of times we tend to move more towards warming than clearing heat. Clearing heat is something that happens in excess conditions. The heat's an exterior pathogen, but our bodies need heat to survive. We need to generate heat. So a cold condition is much more chronic and more of a problem than a hot condition, because cold means that there's a lack of life force already. That's why we use moxibustion, is we want to warm up the system as much as we can to give that extra energy, right? With shiatsu or acupuncture, we're not adding anything in. We're just moving things around, right? And so any extra, like moxa or herbs or diet, those are where we can actually put things in. So the shoestring points are very useful because it helps the body to warm up. If you're going to do moxa, those are often very good points to do moxibustion, because that's where you're putting it directly into the channel. The shoestring points are associated with the summer season. So during the summertime, those points are more active. Problems that happen in the summertime, usually best treated by shoestring points. These ones are also good for joint pain and heaviness in the limbs and joints. And so a lot of times the shoestring points are used as a diagnostic. So if for whatever reason you can't do hard diagnosis, you can palpate the shoestring points. And so for the yin channels, that's easy. They're all the source points as well. For the yang channels, they're not the source points. They are before the source points. So again, back to large intestine, just because it's easy to show, right? There's large intestine 1, 2, 3. This is jingwell, ying spring, shoestring. And then 4 is the source point. And then we move to 5, which is the river point, and 11, which is the husi point. So the river points are, I use the river points almost always the first thing I think about when I do river points is there's a change in the voice. They treat a change in the voice. And so if you hear like that singing tone, that's the earth element imbalance, or if you hear the deep, like gravelly, groaning sound of water element imbalance, or if you hear the crying sound of metal element imbalance, or the laughing sound of fire element imbalance, if you hear that in the voice, you don't always see, just because somebody has a metal imbalance, you don't always hear that sound in their voice. That's just one of the signs to look for. But if you hear that sound in the voice, then you know, okay, river points are going to be helpful for this person. And so whenever I hear that, I'm always like, oh yeah, I'm gonna use some Jing river points on this patient. And so you can think about, let's say for example, it's a person comes in, metal element imbalance. I can hear that sad sound in their voice, that crying sound. But then when they lay down and I assess them and everything else considered, maybe they're actually there's more going on in spleen, right? Which, you know, spleen is the mother of lungs, right? This is the natural sequence of things. So if you treat spleen, you're going to improve the lungs as well, because it's going to follow in that order, right? But I will probably think about, oh, well, I'm going to spend some time on the river point on the spleen channel. And you should take a screenshot, because these are all the points listed for each one, so you can see them. So you can choose the river point on the spleen channel, which is the metal point. And so you're going to utilize that strategy to, although you're treating spleen because that's their primary imbalance, you're also treating the voice because you're using the river point, and you're treating metal because you're using the metal point. And so then the next one are the C points. The C points are very, very useful. And I really like C points for shiatsu especially, because the C points are in meaty places. You know, they're in the muscle, they're near the joint. You can really sink your thumb into them. sometimes you can even sink your elbow into them because the C points are, they're not close to the bone. And so these are nice points to do deeper techniques on. And this is where the qi is flowing deeper into the body. This is where it's no longer running superficial and it's going deeper in. And this is where you can access more the organs themselves through the C points. If you want to access the organs, you know, the front mu points, the back shu points, and the C points are the ones where it's going to most directly reach into the organ. Beyond the C points, all these points on the upper limbs are less useful because they're deeper. The energy is deeper and you can't reach through them to effect as much change. There's more cushion between you and that energy that's deeper within. So C points are one of the most common things I think about with the C points are issues with the skin. Like if there's rashes, eczema, sunburn, anything like that with the skin, then C points are useful. And you would think, oh, the skin is like very superficial. Why is it that the C points, if they go so deep, why are they working on the skin and not the Jing points? Well, C points also, because they're going so deep, they work with the blood a lot. And most skin conditions are actually coming from the blood. It's a blood issue. It's not often a Wei Qi level issue. It's a deeper blood level issue. And so the C points are being deeper, more substantial points. They treat the blood more. And so also the C points are associated with the fall season when a lot of skin issues tend to happen, and then also digestive tract. So if somebody has diarrhea, constipation, vomiting, nausea, those are good times to use the husi points. Okay, can you go to the next slide, please? So I would suggest taking a screenshot of this one as well, because it gives you a list of the points so you can put them to use right away. So I'll discuss a little bit the Harari mother and son. The Harari point is the point on a channel that is the same element as that channel. So on a metal channel, lung 8 is the metal point on the lung channel. Large intestine 1 is the metal point on the large intestine channel. That means it's kind of the most neutral point. If you want to affect that channel in a way that is not going to imbalance other elements, you can use the Harari point. For example, if I'm using the spleen channel as the mother of lung to strengthen the lung channel, I'm going to use, but lung, let's say in this example, lung is primary imbalance, most kyo, right? And so because I want to treat that kyo, I will obviously treat lung channel, but I'm going to support that by also treating spleen channel. So then I'll use spleen 3, because spleen 3 is the Harari point. It's this earth point of the earth channel. And I don't want to imbalance other elements, getting them involved. I just want to just increase a little bit of wood of earth element to help metal element. When I'm treating the lung channel, if that's the primary imbalance, then I'm going to use the mother point. So the mother point is the point on the channel that is the most useful for tonification. And so the mother point is the preceding element in the generating cycle. It's the mother element. So earth generates metal. So you use the earth point on the metal channel to tonify lungs, which would be lung 9. Most of these examples I'm discussing yin channels, because I find that the yin channels are more useful on a broader scale, because the natural tendency of things is that yang is coming out of that yin. And so, and those organs are deeper, the yin organs are deeper. And so there's more use to those points. The yang channels are very good for first aid. They're very good for fixing the symptom that just happened. Whereas the yin channels are better for correcting the imbalance that allowed that symptom to happen in the first place. And the way that I like to work is I focus on that. I focus on the primary imbalance, and then the symptoms tend to resolve on their own. So it's less work to address the yin channels and let the yang channels follow suit than to address the yang channels first and then try and correct the imbalance underneath. Because using this system, the subtlety of it allows me to not have to worry about those symptoms, not have to worry about the yang channels. The only time I really spend a lot of time with yang channels is somebody comes in an acute crisis, like they just spent 8 hours at the beach and they come back red like a lobster. Their skin is like burning hot and they're nauseous and vomiting because they overexpose themselves to the sun. Okay, let's go into the yang channels. Let's do large intestine 11 and sanjiao and clear all this heat out, right? But I prefer 95% of the time, I just address the yin channels primarily. And then if there's still imbalance in the yang channels after addressing the yin channels, then I address a little bit the yang channels. The sun points are the next point in the generating cycle on a channel. So if you're on the metal channel, the next point in the generating cycle is water. So the water point on a metal channel will be the best point for dispersing that channel. Because if you disperse the sun, the mother then has to give extra energy to feed that. And so let's go back to lung and spleen being our primary concern, right? If there's excess in spleen, the next channel is lung. So you would want to disperse the metal element in spleen. So that would be spleen 5. You disperse that point. And so you'll probably find that point to be jitsu. If this is really the dynamic that they're having, you'll probably find that point to be jitsu. And so then you go to spleen afterwards and you don't want to mess with anything else because you got it pretty nice and balanced. So if you're going to augment that dispersion on spleen channel, you're going to disperse the horari point because that's the earth point on the earth channel and it will affect the other things least. Okay, can we go to next slide, please? I already kind of discussed source points a little bit out of order, but the source points are the primary points for managing the flow in the channel. They tend to have a warming nature and they're useful as a diagnostic just through palpation. Do you feel those to be kyo or jitsu? Do they feel them to be tender? Those are good indications of an imbalance in a particular channel. And then the low points. Oh, the low points. This could be a whole class just by itself. These are probably my favorite point classification. So low points are the connecting points. They're also called transporting points or there's another name for it I can't think of right now. But the connecting points or transporting points, they connect the yin and yang pair. So usually what you end up finding is if one channel is kyo, if lung is kyo, large intestine will be jitsu. Or if large intestine is kyo, lung will be jitsu. When we treat, at least in Zen Shiatsu, we don't usually pick our most kyo and most jitsu from the same element. They're usually, even if that's what it feels like, we'll usually tend to pick from separate elements. So the next most kyo or jitsu will choose if it shows up as being both on the same element. Because it's not as effective to treat just two channels from one element. But if that's what you feel, next time you can experiment with this. Next time you're palpating Nahara or the source points or taking the pulse and you say, oh, this large intestine is very jitsu and lung is very kyo. And those really do feel like the most kyo and jitsu points. Just go to the low point, the connecting point, lung 7, large intestine 6. Hold those two points And then after a minute or two, when you feel the energy move, go back, check the heart again. See, does it still show as those as the most kyo and jitsu? Because the yang channel is just at the surface of the yin channel, right? Their pathways, they look like different pathways, but when you take the pulse, they're actually in the same position. And so what you're feeling on the surface is the yang channel. What you're feeling deeper down is the yin channel. And so if there's excess in one, it's usually being displaced from the other. And so by using the low points, you can just easily balance between those two channels. Either low point, either, you know, lung 7 or large intestine 6, if you're working with that pair. And so this is really helpful to balance out those two channels. And the other thing about the transporting points is that this is a place where our body starts to shove things. It's like the closet. It's the closet that, or the junk drawer in the kitchen that you don't know where to put something. And so these points end up collecting, they access the what we call the collateral vessels. These are little small meridians that connect the yin and yang pair. And so if you access those little collateral vessels, what happens is your body, let's say you have a cold and you're fighting it, it's on the surface, but then you're not strong enough to keep it out. So then it comes inward. Well, before it hits your full on like hard fever and, you know, big sweats and everything like that, before it really hits your meridians, your body will first try and stuff it into the low channels and store it there until you can build up enough energy to push it back out. So it's kind of like a transitional phase, things moving deeper. But it's not just pathogens, it's also like emotions. So the low points are super important for emotional disorders because your body will store emotions there. So all of this list of points will be very effective at treating the emotions associated with that element. Because if they're there stored away, being untouched, your body will put them there. And once that's full, then it'll stuff them into your hara, right? So this is, if you do Chi Nei Tsang or any real deep hara work like Ampuku, then these are very important points for you too, because you want to open these up before you go deep into the hara. It'll make it easier for them to push those things back out and process them. It'll be less uncomfortable, that process. Or, you know, if things haven't gotten that deep yet, this is a good way to release them, prevent them from getting so deep that they're actually into the hara. And then the cleft points are mostly just for pain. Each of them sometimes have other indications, but those are something you definitely think of for pain. And in the yin channels, the cleft points are also good for bleeding. So those are important points as well for those things. If you want to stop sharing the slides, I have some flashcards here that I wanted to put up on the screen, please. How much time do I have?
Oh, it's okay. Half an hour.
Oh, perfect.
Going great.
So just to bring some life to all that theory, I have a couple of flashcards here. I think I took one card from every channel. Just as these are some common points that most people who do this kind of work know most of these points. So I tried to choose points that wouldn't be any like surprise to you, that you wouldn't be like, oh, I never used that point. I wanted to choose points that are common and easy to access. But I want to use these examples to explain why. So first one, lung 7. Everybody kind of thinks about lung 7 for neck pain, think of lung 7 for releasing the exterior, right? Well, lung 7 is it's the low point. It's the transporting point. And so lung 7 is, like I said, one of those collateral points where exterior pathogens aggregate on their way moving towards the interior. Large intestine channel ends at the nose. So exterior pathogens coming in, first thing I get is a tickle right here. And then I sneeze because large intestine channel is trying to expel it. if that gets deeper, then it gets into the body, then I start to cough, right? Well, now it's gone from large intestine to lung. How did it get from large intestine to lung? Is it got in there through the low points, went from large intestine 6 to lung 7 into lung. That's the actual pathway the pathogen traveled. And so that's very useful for us. I like to pinch it. I always teach my patients just to pinch lung 7 because this is easy for them to do. And it's easy for them to not miss the point because lung 7 can be a little bit tricky to find sometimes for patients. So I just have them pinch, and if they miss it, then they just pinch up their whole arm right here, and they're getting, you know, they're getting useful stimulation to lung and large intestine channel anyway. Another useful way to do it is a clothespin. I stick a clothespin on there. This is what I do for myself. If I'm just like walking around the house and I have a stiff neck or I feel like something cold coming out, I put a clothespin on lung 7 while I'm doing my whatever around the house before I can get into this room and do some moxibustion, you know? Moxa is my favorite. If I treat myself, I usually treat myself with moxa. I do shiatsu on myself, and I do acupuncture on myself, and I do herbs for myself too. But my first thing is moxa, because I feel like I would rather get shiatsu from someone else or get acupuncture from someone else. And the herbs take an hour to cook, you know, but the moxa is right now. And so that's what I usually do. So that's just an explanation of why lung 7 does what it does. And I'll put a quick question out there. I'll give you 30 seconds if anybody knows. Why does lung 7 treat neck pain? Nobody. So lung 7 is the lung channel on the meridian clock. If you've seen the meridian clock where you have the opposite, like 5 to 7 a.m. is lung channel, and then 5 to 7 p.m. is bladder channel. So this is called Shigo method. This is not five elements. This is not source points or anything like that. This is a whole different theory. I just dropped this little bit right here. Is Shigo is clock opposites. So 5 to 7 a.m. treats 5 to 7 p.m. So lung channel treats bladder channel excess. So if bladder channel is excess, you have pain in the back of the neck, then you tonify lung and you help to disperse the excess in bladder. That's why lung 5 treats low back pain as well, because it's a bladder channel problem. So this is only channels. This doesn't work with internal. It's not an herbal practice or anything like that. It's only shiatsu, acupuncture, only channel-based processes this works. But if you look at the clock, all of that information is there for a reason. It's useful because you can use the opposite channel. And that's another big way that I work in my practice. So next one here, large intestine 11. This is a hussy point, right? And on the yang channels, the C points are earth element. And so this is, although it's a large intestine point, being a hussy point, it treats GI tract issues, right? So obviously large intestine channel, it has to do with the GI tract, but also because it's a C point, it has to do with the digestive tract. And because it's a C point, it also treats the skin. So this is like one of the best points for sunburn or like red hot rashes and stuff like that is large intestine 11. Very important for clearing heat from the skin. But even nausea, vomiting, that's in the stomach. It's not in the large intestine. Large intestine 11 still helps with those, even though it's not the actual large intestine organ because of its function as a C point. It moves into the digestive tract. This is one of my favorites, stomach 40. When I was in acupuncture school, everybody, you know, like I said, they don't tell you why the points work. They just tell you, use this point for this thing. And so everybody says stomach 40 for phlegm. If there's phlegm, use stomach 40. But I had this one teacher who was super nice to everybody else, but he was always really hard on me. But like we ended up becoming good friends because I think he liked to harass me, but he knew that I think he had a greater plan in the harassment, because one day I had this patient in student clinic, had a lot of phlegm, and I was like, okay, well, I'm going to do stomach 40. And he's like, why? I was like, because it's stomach 40 and stomach 40 treats phlegm. He's like, why? And he made me figure out why and explain to him why. So stomach 40 is the yang channel. Phlegm is a yin pathogen, right? And so spleen should transform and transport that phlegm. It shouldn't allow that phlegm to aggregate. If it aggregates, there's a deficiency in spleen allowing that to happen. So you use the transporting point on the yang channel to move yang from stomach channel into spleen so that the spleen has more yang to be able to deal with this, the phlegm. So using this point, you're just shuttling the abundance of qi that is in the yang channel, the yang ming, stomach channel, into the spleen channel, which is bogged down by dampness and phlegm. It needs more yang to transform all that yin pathogen. That's why stomach 40 does what it does, because it's a low point, a transporting point. Here we have spleen 9. Spleen 9 is something that's very common for use with dampness in the body, right? Could be edema, could be foggy mind, could be digestive issues. So being that it's a C point, this one goes in and treats digestive tract. So if somebody has diarrhea, there's excess water in the digestive tract, spleen 9 is a useful point. If they have edema on the skin, spleen 9 is a useful point because that's, again, water. If they have eczema that's weeping and there's all kinds of oozing coming out of it, well, spleen 9 is a C point, so it treats the skin, and it's a water point, so it treats that excess water. And so that's why spleen 9 does some of the things that it does. Also, if you come from a school that discourages dispersing of kidney in any way, there's some schools of thought that you say you never disperse kidney because kidney is the jing, it's the foundation, it's the beginning of all of your life force, right? And so that's a little difficult to harmonize sometimes if you do a style that's depending on just balancing the kyo and the jitsu or the deficiency and the excess. So if you feel the hara and the kidney feels jitsu, or if you take the pulse and the kidney feels excess, it's slippery and it's rapid or something like that, but you're like, oh, well, I don't want to disperse the kidney because, you know, if I disperse the kidney, maybe I'm dispersing their life force or something like that. Spleen 9 is a useful point for that because it's the water point, and who controls water? Earth controls water, right? So if you treat spleen 9, you can sometimes regulate that imbalance without having to disperse kidney. Another good strategy for that is actually you tonify kidney 3. If you use tonification technique on kidney 3 is the earth point on the water channel. So you tonify the earth point, which is the controlling point, the earth energy will control the excess water energy. So you're not dispersing kidney, you're just tonifying the earth within the water to help to hold the water in place so that it's not, because it's not truly excess. They don't have an excess of jing or life force. It's just out of balance at this moment. And so little subtle things like that make these points so, so useful and really explain why they do what they do. Here we go. Heart 8. Heart 8 is when people are nervous, you see them do this all the time. Pericardium 8 and heart 8, they'll massage those points because the person who's doing this has probably got sweaty palms, right? They're probably sweaty armpits. Their probably heartbeat is really fast. They're about to go speak on a Zoom in front of a bunch of people. And so they massage this point because they're clearing heat from the heart, because this is the fire point on the fire channel. So if you're rubbing like this, you're dispersing. And so this helps to clear that heat. Conversely, we rarely see somebody with truly, truly like cold in the heart, but somebody who maybe just had like open heart surgery, or they had a heart attack, or their fingertips are blue now, you know, moxa on these points will help. You have to be careful because you don't want to add too much fire again to the heart. But there are a few occasions where heart is cold and deficient, and you can do moxa on heart 8 or pericardium 8, and that's helpful. Small intestine 6. This is kind of a weird point. It really does work better with a needle than with your finger because it's so small. The way I was taught to needle this point is in this position, because if you're in any other position, the bones move and you can't get to it. But even with my finger in this position, it works better than somewhere else. If you're doing the meridian stretches, you know, if you're stretching small intestine this way, you know, you're still in the right position to hold that point. And sometimes, you know, if you know how to project your qi from your fingertips into them, then you can reach that point better even with your finger than you can with a needle. But the indication for small intestine 6, it says it right on here. It says pain in the shoulder as if it were broken. None of the other points listed say such a strong statement as if it was broken. And so that's a good point for severe pain because it's a Qi cleft point. The Qi cleft points treat severe pain. And so because it's because small intestine is so widespread over the shoulder, it doesn't have to just be small intestine channel, because if you look at some of the internal pathways, it will affect the front of the shoulder as well, even up into here, not just what we think of as that little zigzag over the shoulder blade. So bladder 40, we usually think of bladder 40 for back pain. That's a real common point for low back pain. But being that it's a C point, bladder 40 also is useful for skin issues. Sunburn, red rashes, itchy rashes, because it's a C point. Also about bladder 40, not because of its position as an antique point, but because it's where the sinews bind. If you look at the sinew channels, bladder 40 is also useful. That's why it's useful for back pain, because the sinews bind there. They come down from the upper PSIS, you know, where quadratus lumborum reaches the sacrum and the upper border of the iliac crest, and it binds there. And then it binds again at the ischium, and then it binds again at the back of the knee. And so treating the bladder 40 releases the sinew channel, which then affects the low back. Kidney 2 is the fire point on the water channel. It's a yin spring point. So being the fire point on the water channel, this is a useful point for treating hot flashes. So hot flashes are, they're heat, but it's not true heat, right? It's not exterior heat. It's not, I got a sunburn heat, or I ate too much chili heat, I don't have a fever. Hot flashes happen due to deficiency. After a person has passed menopause and they've started to deplete their yin and their blood, they get heat because there's an imbalance of yin. There's not enough yin. It's not that there's too much heat. So you treat kidney 2 to help to strengthen the yin, but also control the fire, because water controls fire. Pericardium 5. So pericardium 5 is a river point, which means it's the metal point. And river points manifest in the voice. So pericardium has a lot to do, being a fire point, has a lot to do with the Shen and the spirit. Sometimes you meet somebody who has kind of disjointed way of talking, and they kind of slur their words a little bit like they're drunk, but they're not drunk. And they kind of say things that don't quite match, or you ask them a question and they don't answer your question. They answer something else because they didn't really understand you. This is like kind of the sign of, we call it phlegm misting the spirit. There's this phlegmy layer between their perception of the outside world. Their spirit is not able to interact clearly with the outer world because of this phlegm. So pericardium 5 is the metal point. And so you hear in their voice, because it's a Jing River point, it's treating the voice. And because it's a metal point, you hear it in their voice, this existence of phlegm. This is not the same kind of phlegm that you cough up and spit out. This is a spiritual phlegm. And so pericardium 5 is useful point for treating that. Oh, well, I ended up with two pericardium points, but pericardium 4 being a Shiklef point treats pain. So this is good for chest pain. If somebody has angina, if they're having a heart attack, you know, obviously, please call 911. But in the meantime, while you wait for them to get there, pericardium 4 is going to be a helpful point that will help to move that blood that's stagnating in the heart and to help to soften the pain that's there. And you can use it for emotional pain too. If it's an emotional pain that affects the heart or the even anywhere in the chest, pericardium 4 is going to be helpful. Sanjiao 10, this one is also a C point. So like I said, a lot of the C points in this list because they're some of the most useful ones. So Sanjiao 10 being a C point on a yang channel, we also call it triple heater, right? This is an earth point. So earth connects to spleen, which transforms phlegm. So Sanjiao 10, this is right here, is indicated for nodules in the thyroid and scrofula and different kinds of like phlegmy nodules that happen in the throat. Well, those are categorized as a stagnation of phlegm or sometimes a stagnation of blood. But scrofula and thyroid nodules, usually it's phlegm. And so if you think about what do you treat thyroid with, a lot of times it's seaweed. Seaweed is categorized in the herbal materia medica as an herb that treats phlegm. But again, it's not the phlegm you spit out. It's another kind of phlegm that's forming into tumors. And so Sanjiao, because it is the earth point on the fire channel, you're using that fire to augment earth because fire is the mother of earth. Earth is the mother of fire. So you are using that point with the earth energy and the fire energy to treat those nodules. Gallbladder 44. So this is a Jingwell point. Jingwell points are the farthest away you can get from one side of the channel, right? They're always the tips of the fingers or toes. So a lot of times we like to use the farthest point away to treat the opposite side of the channel. So gallbladder 44 is indicated for all this like gallbladder channel pain in the head, the side of the head, the eyes, red eyes, burning eyes, because gallbladder ends here. So gallbladder 44 on the tip of the toe clears heat from all up here in the head, gallbladder channel, because it's a Jingwell point. And then last one in the cycle here, liver 4. So liver, in a TCM approach, liver is always excess. Many TCM doctors will only treat liver qi stagnation. There's no such thing as liver deficiency. In Shiatsu, we find you can palpate the heart and find kyo in the liver. You can palpate the channel and find kyo in the channel. In Hari, meridian therapy is same thing. You can find deficiency in the liver pulse. So these more meridian-based practices, we do believe in and treat liver deficiency. That being said, liver does have a tendency to excess. for many reasons. One, this is the last card on my stack. Why is it the last card on my stack? Because the stack comes in order of the channel circuit. Starts with lung and ends with liver. So at the end of your whole day, when you've processed everything, whatever doesn't get processed, guess who has to deal with it? The liver. So of course the liver gets excess. Of course the liver gets angry and frustrated because all these other organs didn't do their job to process things through the day. And now the liver has to deal with it. So that's why liver tends towards excess. But liver four is the metal point on the liver channel. So a lot of times you'll find mixed excess and deficient signs in liver. If you treat liver four, you help to use the metal to control the wood because metal controls wood. And so you can control liver that way without necessarily dispersing or tonifying that channel. You just treat liver four, a kind of even technique, and that can be helpful. So that's all I have for you today. I hope that that's useful information and I hope it was interesting for you. And I'm teaching a class starting next Friday, a 6-week class on the antique points. And this is kind of covered like the first half of class 1 and 2, but I'm gonna go through all 5 points on each channel with indications and little tidbits like that. Thank you.
That's great, thank you, Chilán. I love it. I loved your presentation. It's so much fun. I love the 5 elements. I love the points, tiny little points, but such a gives us great impact in our bodies. So everybody's okay? Do you have any questions? Eva, you had a lot of questions to Chilán.
I'm so impressed, Chilán, with your great knowledge and such a pleasure to listen to you. And wow. Really, thank you so much. I don't have any questions regarding antique points. If anyone has some, please ask or yourself or in the chat. But I do have some questions about your past, because you have such interesting past. You are a Native American and you grew up in an environment of healers, right? Can you tell us about your history? That's so beautiful.
Well, a lot of those teachings as far as techniques and things are secret. They're not things that we share outside of the community. So I can't really talk about like specifics, techniques about it, but just my history is that from like 5 years old, my uncle started taking me with him to pick different herbs, and he would take me and show me, okay, this plant, this is how you collect it. This is, you know, the right time to collect it. This is how you use it. And there's always more to the way that we use herbs. There's more to it than just the chemicals in the plant. You know, there's the spirit of the plant. We look at, how does this plant grow? How does it talk to us? What does it tell us through the way it talks to us? And so we use it a lot of times in ways that are atypical. If you look in an herb book about, you know, oh, this plant does this thing, you know, because we are working with also the spirit of the plant. And the way that comes about is really just, it's being present. It's being present in the moment. It's listening deeply, not just with your ears, but listening deeply. When you touch the plant, when you smell the plant, how is it speaking to you? How does it feel when you hold it or feel it? And so those are the real important things, you know. Some of the, you know, the ceremonies and the specific ways of doing healings and stuff, those are secret because those have been they've been taken out of context so many times. They've been taken out of the community so many times. And there was a period of time where those things were illegal to practice as well. Until 1979, it wasn't legal in the United States for Native Americans to practice their religion. 1979.
Wow.
That was the year before I was born. And so that's why a lot of those techniques and specifics are kept secret to this day. And so I grew up that way. And then as I got older, you know, I went through my teenage years where I wasn't like so engaged. And then when I got back into my 20s, I kind of re-engaged with a lot of those teachings on a deeper level and committed myself to a healing path. At the same time I went to school for Shiatsu and started learning Shiatsu, I also started doing a lot more of our traditional ceremonies and learning that way too. And so I was fortunate to grow up with it. So it wasn't like coming from the outside in to learn and having to sort through preconceptions from the Western world about the way the universe is. I had grown up with a certain cosmovision from our traditions. And so when I came back to those things in later in life, it was very easy for me to integrate that into my being because the ideas and the concepts were already ingrained in me. I already saw the world that way rather than seeing it in a different way and having to come back and try and change my world vision. And so through just my own commitment to ceremony and being in that practice all the time, I learned a lot of techniques and ceremonies and practices along the way. And so I've been given permission from our community, from the elders in our community to lead certain kinds of ceremonies and to do certain kinds of healing work. And so I do those things as well, but I really kind of keep that just within our community because those are, for one, those things we're not allowed to take money for. Those are given from the ancestors, they're given from our community for the reason of taking care of our community, for the reason of our survival as a people. And so we're not allowed to charge money or take money for those things. And so that's one of the reasons why I went to Shiatsu school and I went to acupuncture school and I studied herbs because I wanted to dedicate myself to that kind of work, but I didn't want to do healing work at home and work at a gas station during the day so that I could try and pay rent, you know? I wanted to be able to do healing work both sides of the clock, you know? And so on weekends, we do ceremonies and I take care of my community in that way. And then during the day, I go to the clinic and I see patients that way.
And what kind of ceremonies?
So there's an, I shouldn't really talk about them. Sweat lodge is one of the ceremonies that we do, but there's also certain dances and other ceremonies that we do.
What is the topics of the ceremonies, the intention that you can tell us, I hope.
The intention is to cleanse yourself. Mm-hmm. The intention is to strengthen your own personal power and your own personal connection to spirit. The intention a lot of times is healing, like ceremonies will be done for a particular person who's sick. So then we'll do like a healing ceremony for that person. The ceremonies are for strengthening the community and the bonds within the community. Ceremony, a lot of times the intention is to learn something or to, you know, to get a better understanding about a particular thing. And so depending, you know, how people come together and why the ceremony is being done, we can set the attention different ways. But they definitely, my two worlds that I'm living in, they inform each other. And so the traditional native ceremonies that I do, they inform my acupuncture practice and my shiatsu practice. And then that also informs my traditional healing because at the end, these are two paths that are going to the top of the same mountain. The truth is there. The truth is at the top of the mountain and it's just one truth. There's only one source and we have different ways of accessing and interpreting that. But at the end, it's just one source. And so the more I walk up the mountain, those two paths, they get closer and closer together and harder to distinguish one from the other.
Yes, we are so grateful to have this profession, right? Yeah. Yes. We want more people to be able to give shiatsu, acupuncture, acupressure, and have a happy, joyful life and help others.
Yes.
We are so grateful to have you with us. also because the knowledge that you carry and with you is so rare and so important to carry on and to teach people and to be in contact with you is healing.
Thank you.
So yes. And I have a question also about the community. I understand it's a community of Native Americans, and how many people are there in the community, and how you grew up, where?
So I live in Tucson now. So I've been here, well, on and off since 2003, but most recently, just I've been here for 4 years now. And so there's other communities in town here too, that we kind of, you know, there's our community, but there's other people too that we interact with often. And so how many people is there? Oh, it's hard to say, you know, any day it could be just four or five of us, or it could be 20 or 30 of us, because there's overlap between different communities too. And we try and do our best to be supportive of other communities that are around as well.
Oh, okay. And you told me at the rehearsal that you lived everywhere.
Yeah. I've lived in Los Angeles, Las Vegas, Colorado, South Dakota, Montreal, New York, Johannesburg, Albuquerque, and Tucson.
Wow.
And I hope to live somewhere else again still. So I hope to live in South America one day.
But you said Johannesburg, so South America. Oh,
yeah.
Okay. That's nice. So you're a citizen of the world.
Yes.
Okay, good. I'm really curious about the culture that you're representing, and I think you are a treasure, and we are very happy to have you with us. Thank you. And also, during the rehearsal, I did, we spoke about how to occupy kids during the pandemic and after pandemic, because kids are so sensitive and suffer so much being isolated from their friends. And they suffer with anxiety, depression, and a lot of health problems. And do you have any ideas? Because you have a young daughter. How old is your daughter?
She's 13 now.
13, okay. So what is your idea, and what's your advice?
Being that she's a little bit older, I think it would have been much harder if this happened 4 years ago and she was still very childish, but she's kind of a teenager now, you know? And so her interests are different, and, you know, she sleeps more, and, you know, she's not as crazy active as when she was little. So I've spent a lot of time with her just teaching her the skills that I have that she won't learn in school, teaching her how to do moxa. She can roll OQ now. And I'll have her do OQ on me and roll moxa, and teaching her five element, teaching her the interaction of the five elements, and the controlling and the mother-son relationship. I know that she won't learn in school, and keep her occupied with that. And I quiz her and stuff, you know. We'll just be walking to the park to walk the dogs, and I'll quiz her, you know, like, okay, what's the mother element that controls this or that, you know?
And you said about meditation, that you're never too young to learn meditation.
Yes, right? Definitely. Yes, we've been doing meditation as well. And, you know, teaching her how to control her breath and how to get into those deeper mind spaces and connect with the subconscious and not end up in a lot of automated patterns that we end up in, and we start kind of picking those things up as we transition into adulthood, because children, are their minds are flexible, they don't have those patterns yet, but as we solidify into adult bodies, then we start to pick up automated patterns, and we lose present moment consciousness. And so I've been trying to help her to learn skills to not let that happen as much as she transitions into adulthood.
Nice. Okay, we have a question from Pauline, and she's asking if you have any songs that you share with your daughter as well, or any songs that you...
She sings some songs. You know, she's a teenager, so she's into the music that the teenagers are into now. She doesn't sing a whole lot ceremonial songs. We try and get her to, but she's a little bit resistant as a teenager.
Okay, but you do have in your culture songs that you use for healing.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
The songs are, in my particular tradition, some people have songs that are specific healing songs. In our tradition, the songs are more about changing the energy so that whoever's doing the healing can do that. The songs kind of, they're fuel to carry that.
Oh, that's interesting. Are there also a sacred secret, or is it possible to find somewhere on YouTube?
You could probably find a lot of songs on YouTube. I don't know if some people might be upset that they're on there, but they are there. So you can find them if you want to listen to them.
Okay. I'll look for sure. Okay. So I think it is all for today. Thank you very much.
In the chat box, I put the link to the class that I'm teaching next week. If anybody's interested, it's there.
Oh, great. I'll share it on our social media as well.
Okay. Thank you so much. It was good to meet you all.
Thank you.
Some faces I recognize. Good to see you, Yoshi.
Yoshi is here too, Chilán. Thank you for coming today, sharing your tradition, your healing.
Thank you. You're going to be a regular.
I hope so.
Definitely. Thank you.
Hi, Yoshi.
Hi.
Hi, everybody. So
we hi, Kamiko-san.
Hi, both hands together and gassho. And thank you for this beautiful day. Thank you, Chilán, for guiding us and everybody coming together today. So have a beautiful day and be safe and happy. Please help everybody, whoever you can give a healing hands to. And let's learn five elements and tsubos and take points. Such a powerful tools we just learned from Chilán. Thank you and see you soon. Yes. Let's listen to the message from kids. It's such a fun song. I hope everybody can dance with them. Yes, sound is
oh, wow. I guess we have to sing our own songs. Okay.
Can you see the meridians? Can you see the gallbladder?
What? No.
We will make it. We will do it. Let's make a fun. She has a kids group. Can you hear?
Maybe Pauline can sing a song.
Chilán, please help us.
Yes, the young generation.
Yes.
The kids are so much in social media, and because of pandemic, they really need.
We need to merge.
Yeah.
Everything can join us. Can you see?
Yeah, and we really need to focus our messages also to young, to kids, to teenagers.
Definitely, shiatsu for everybody.
Yeah. And make shiatsu cool, super cool.
Yeah, to see you.
Kumiko.
Yeah.
Can you hear? You don't hear music either, right?
Have a great week. Bye bye. See you. See you soon.
Okay.